making sure that the corporate risk register progresses to publication, which it will do next month. The terms of 323 in training services for schools and academies. So as part of our business-to-business project where we sell council services to schools and academies and any other kind of parties that would wish to buy our services, risk and insurance services are now included within that brochure for next year, so that we're actually hoping to trade some of those services with schools and academies, and the risk and insurance team should get some income in on the back of that. In terms of the procurement of the replacement claim management system, so our insurance claim management system needs replaced and it is outdated, and some RFQs, request for quotations, have actually been developed and have been published, will be published on the council's chest shortly, so we'll be looking forward to receiving those in terms of replacing that system.
That
can see
the
fees,
by the way.
It has been to the just moving on to 325, so procurement of motor insurance and engineering inspection contracts. So tender's actually been out for those already, and we have received a submission for that. So we're actually just going through and analysing those submissions, and they will come back to the committee once those bids have been evaluated. Liability claims handling, so you'll be aware that part of the highways, council's highways contract actually came back in to the council from the 1st of October. And we have been transitioning that to make sure that it's kind of business as usual with any claims, to make sure that there's no gaps in the provision of claims from the handover from our employer to the council. And we've made some provision in terms of our insurance fund for those claims, which we'll actually come on to in the next report. The next report is the insurance fund budget, so we'll come on to that. And then the final one is the renewal of the liability and computer insurance costs. And we do have kind of multi-year contracts for these, but as best practice on an ongoing basis, we review them on an annual basis, so we just make sure that they are fit for purpose. There's no changes, or if there's any significant changes, that we do take them into account, and we might review the contracts in respect of those, and anything that we do find that might need review, we will report to the committee. So that was just an update really in terms of the activities from our team's chair.
David. Just a very quick one, I'm sorry. Very quick one, Chair. You mentioned 325, the procurement of motor insurance and engineering inspection. Just two very quick questions. Did you get the sort of response you would have expected from that? Were they within some sort of budget that you would have already previously decided to cover that particular eventuality?
Yeah, thank you, Chair. I believe we did get the response, and as far as I'm aware, they were in the budget. If they were outside of it, to take you through some of the areas within the report. In terms of 3.2, point 8 on self-funded risks. So there's a list there of all the insurance areas that we self-fund ourselves, but we only self-fund them up to a certain value. So if something goes over the value, we actually have external insurance for that. So for example, if you see a casualty, we would self-fund up to 3.2 million. If we have any funds that go over 3.2 million, we have got external insurance for that. The reason for self-funding is it's much cheaper, basically. And we manage this on an annual basis. Every year, on an ongoing basis, we do check the self-funding and make sure that, depending on where we are in terms of our limits, and it's an ongoing, as I say, an ongoing process to make sure that we're still within our limits, and we're not kind of reaching our limits in terms of what we have set aside in terms of contingency. So we've got five or six, maybe a few more categories there in terms of all the self-funding. In terms of the specific insurance contracts that we have, and the premiums that we have for the external insurance, we've got a couple of areas there listed in 3.9. So we have casualty insurance, which has gone through a competitive tender process. It has come out higher, but as I said before, we do have provision for contingency in the insurance fund. We've been able to offset the additional extra amount there from the insurance fund. Just in terms of the changes for the premiums for casualty, and the table there on page 38, just kind of gives you an indication of the increase in costs in terms of the external insurance, and let's say we are managing that through our own internal insurance fund. So at the moment, the external insurance for casualty is up to £252,000. But we actually self-insure from our fund up to 1.5 million. Our report really just goes through in terms of the different categories. So point B on that page is material damage and business interruption. Again, we have self-insurance for some of those, a lot smaller in terms of some of the other insurance that we have. And then again, we manage that for a maximum claims, internal claims. So that if we did go above that, we do have external insurance as well that we tend to. The comprehensive motor insurance, again, similar situation there. We have the insurance fund, which for next year is £80,000. And again, if we go above that, we have the external insurance fund as well that we tend to follow. In terms of the other risks, I mean, there are three other main classes in terms of risks that we have within the organisation. There are as an administration as well that comes into the insurance budget that we have to fund, which obviously includes my time and the cost of his team as well. So 314 just gives you an indication of the comparison of the budget of last year and for next year in terms of the insurance budget, and you'll see there the additional cost for next year. And just draw your attention to one item in that report, really, is on the claims database. So I mentioned before that we are anticipating that we are going to renew our insurance fund claims database next year. The budget does look significantly higher, it's more than double, so it's gone up from £8,000 to £20,000 for the claims. And that's because when we have the new claims, we'll have one off costs in the first year, so there will be some additional costs in the year one, and then what will happen is it will level off the future years. And in terms of the actual insurance budget that we have, in 3.15, just an indication there of the budget under schools, the general fund, and also the academy. So the financial implications, just given a summary of what I mentioned in terms of how much the budget is increasing for next year. And as I said, that's mainly because of the self-funding that we've made provision for the hangers contract.
David?
Yes, thank you, Chair. Just a quick commentary. One of the most interesting features of this document is 3.2 on page 36, which of course I haven't appreciated, Chair, that by self-insuring we avoid insurance tax, and we also avoid not getting any money back when we've not paid a claim or whatever. So there is a double whammy benefit in that, in fact, in self-insuring, provided you've got the resource and the capability to do so. Interesting comment, if you appreciate that in some context, which I haven't realised that. Thank you for making that clear. Thank you.
Jeff?
Yeah, thanks.
So
again,
a bit of
a comment on thanks to Mike, because he does an amazing job and has done over, as many years as I can remember anyway, in terms of how he manages this in an incredibly cost-effective way. I suppose I might have missed it, so give me just a couple of points of clarification, that's okay. First of all, I think you said, looking at this, it's going to be an extra 10,000, it's the actual cost to the you know, to the budget. But I thought that you said the actual increase is a lot more than 10,000, but it's going to be covered by the insurance fund. So we're going to use one-offs to cover an ongoing revenue commitment this year. If I've misunderstood that, if you could. And tell us how much we're dipping into the insurance fund for this year, because you mentioned it quite a few times, I think. And then what it stands at now, and whether you're looking to rebuild the insurance fund. Because again, the balances, one presumes, and it's not the balance as such, but we're consistently told that if you take money out of balances, then you have to rebuild them, or you should think about rebuilding them for the following year, so that they're there again to look for. So, just some clarity around those particular issues, if that's okay.
So, in terms of the insurance fund, I think 315 there, in that fund, which is the one-off fund, if you like. And what we do is, there will be money to work so that's almost 3 million. So what we have is the monies that come in and out of that fund. So for insurance that we recharge schools, so we actually recharge schools for insurance and for academies, the income that they pay comes back into that fund. And every quarter, Mike and his team will do an analysis of the claims that we actually get through, and they will look at that fund and make a determination as to whether it's sufficient, whether it's robust, and if there is enough contingency going forward. And if there isn't, that will form part of our sort of budget setting process or our pressures process, and he will present that as part of that medium-term financial strategy. And what could happen is that the fund will be replenished in that case, and where we are sort of charging schools and say the academies, that does replenish the fund and the income that comes back in from them anyway. So we're not kind of reducing it year on year on year, but there's money that goes in and out. And also where we can self-insure, so where we do get tenders in, on the occasions where tenders are less, then the recharge then. Any additional the reduction, if you like, in the actual tenders that we recharge across the insurance, that will come back into the fund as well. So we're not sort of reducing it on an ongoing basis. And if we were to reduce it, because there could be significant levels of self-insurance or something's happened that we've had to pay out a specific amount of insurance for a specific reason, we would take a view on that as a council. And if it does fall below a level that's not going to be, then we will replenish that fund. We need to make sure. There is sometimes people will say that we have too much reserves, I guess, in terms of what they are in all our reserves, but it's got to be taken in the round. So some of those reserves will include the insurance fund, which I don't think people appreciate sometimes, and that is part of our reserves process. So where sometimes, yeah, we will review those. Sometimes we get commentary to say that we should be reducing our reserves. One of the reserves we don't do with the insurance fund, so we need to make sure that it's robust.
So, thanks. Thank you. I'm almost going to say, so how much have we, so there's an additional cost to the general fund of 10,000 this year?
That's what you're asking for.
Do. Which I presume that gets in the mix in terms of what ends up getting agreed, which is so how much have you had to use the insurance fund to cover this extra cost that we've picked up because we've insourced the contract, the roads contract, which I think you mentioned was quite a large amount of money. So how much have we taken out of the insurance fund to cover that expenditure?
So we haven't taken any out. So the insurance fund.
How much have you earmarked then?
So in terms of the change in the fund, it's £194,000. £50,000. So what we've done is kind of like we've worked on the forms of the amounts set aside for different elements of insurance that have been what we've said is we're going to set aside £194,000 in terms of the highways contract. What we do is that when we apportion insurance, so we apportion the insurance costs to recharge it to all the different departments of the council. And what we will do every year is we will change that recharge up and down depending on what happens with the fund. So what we will do is we will recharge different departments of the council £194,000 with the additional cost, but we will still retain that within the insurance fund. So it's an accounting entry, if you like. So in terms of our support services recharges, we will just recharge that to all the different departments.
Right, I understand it's an accountancy measure for yourself, money in, money out. One presumes that's another £194,000 that various departments have to find from their savings profile to cover that £194,000. So if there be real money somewhere, that it will be because you recharge that additional cost to the rest of the council. Can I again just be clear? There will be no extra cost or implication to schools, academies, etc. The people that we are mentioning in this report about where we're going out to work to cover this £194,000, that we've chosen to pay for it out of the insurance fund rather as a direct cost on people, on departments, or raising the cost of people's departments' budgets.
So what I'm saying to you is that if the charges to schools have gone up, we will increase the charge to schools. In terms of academies, that's actual cash charges, and they choose to buy the insurance and the risk budget, or the functions, should I say, back from us. So they're all within the right to say to accept the charges or not, really, they'll get their own. With schools, where there is an increased charge to schools, we will talk to schools and inform the schools of that before they're actually increased. So it would be sort of like, I'm not entirely sure exactly how much it would be. I can find that out from Mike, but it would be sort of like a percentage increase depending on whatever the increased insurance would be that's specifically related to schools. We do a separate calculation for schools rather than the rest of the council. So this specific £194,000 is only to the general fund. That doesn't take into account any
Thank you, Chair. I see no further hands up. So, can I take it that the insurance fund, that the insurance fund budget be agreed?
Yeah,
agreed. So, on to the next item. This is Grant Thornton. Stuart, welcome back.
Thank you, Chair. So, I guess that's how I'm going to introduce myself. I'm Stuart Passman, and I'm the Assistant Audit Manager. Obviously, this is my first time from the Assistant Committee. So this is just a brief update really. Since last time we presented to the committee, there hasn't been too much external audit action. I have noticed a couple of typos in the report, apologies for that. The main areas of work that we've been since the last time we presented to you are a couple of grant certifications, namely that was the housing benefits work and the teacher's pension. So both those were certified in line with line. So just like to thank all of the finance staff for their help with those. They went very smoothly. The rest of the course is looking at how we're gearing up to the 18-19 financial statements and quite the money work that we're performing. So in March we've got our interim audit scheduled where we'll be coming on site to the council and we'll be getting them standing financial systems, updating our documentation, reviewing any order reports and coming some error testing where we can on controls and substantively, just to sort of move some burden away from the very condensed period in June and July. We are also going to be performing our white money work, which is looking at the bridge criteria of informed decision making, sustainable resource deployment, and working with farmers. Our initial graphic risk assessment will be completed in the next few months. and previous years, namely being managing overhead controls, which is a standard risk under the accounting, under reporting standards, and valuing from land and buildings, and valuing of the pension fund net liability. These are obviously some of the largest figures in the accounts and have a large degree of estimated uncertainty and assumptions in how they're derived, and those are standard significant risks for accounts of this size. Following on from that, we've got a brief set of updates with a few reports. The first one is a piece of work that we are doing in terms of trying to look at how adult social care is funded and possible ways of letting it change in the future. So that's a quite interesting work, such a work that also transport and taking. Following on from that, we've got a report on latest trends in local quality trading companies. It's quite interesting. The different models of trading companies which authorities are setting up, some best practice and case studies, a few critical success factors. So again, that's quite an interesting report. And finally, a report from ICAEW on the expectations gap, namely around the responsibilities of the Cllr auditor and looking at potential change in those responsibilities going forward, whether like the decreased audit fees, the So again, it's quite an interesting report on some core issues. At the back of the report, there's links to all those reports if anyone wants to read them in more detail, but other than that, I'm happy to say something.
Okay, Paul, I've got plenty of questions. I think let's put Jeff first. And I think Paul.
Mine's really useful. Just on page 4 of your report, last paragraph on the right-hand side says, objection, we've spoken to officers over the last couple of weeks to clarify a number of issues and hope to be able to take the objection to the next stage over the next couple of weeks. So what is the objection? And what that sounds a little bit worrying, so...
Yeah, that's a long-standing objection from, I think, 2015-16, growth around the logos. So naturally there's been some movement on those, and we are expecting that we'll be able to have an answer to that objection over the next few months.
Sorry, if we get an answer to what does that mean? So is it good, is it bad, or could it be good, could it be bad?
So,
why does it matter?
The objection was raised a few years ago in relation to some prior loans taken out at interest rates. And that, the objection being placed means we can't formally close the accounts. So, hopefully, in the next couple of months, we'll be able to give an answer on our position in relation to the objection. And obviously, we've got to give some closure to that.
The objection that was raised a few years back was that the loans, the loans we entered into were legal about them. I think the conclusion of the objection will hopefully say that we didn't enter illegally into that's what I'm hoping. I'm not predetermining the outcome. We are hoping, yeah, that the outcome would be that we didn't enter into them illegally. And at the time, they were the best deal for the organisation, the authority. This is a countrywide objection, so it's not just Wirral, it's a whole thing we care about. So we will put a link to that, really, to kind of, as Stuart says, draw a line on it, and then we can formally say all our accounts are concerned, and accurately, and there's no one doing this all the time.
Sorry, the implication there, for some reason, I found that they had acted illegally.
That's an interesting question, I don't know the answer.
I would say that I'm shocked.
You may be called up some quite taking notes?
I think potentially the answer would be is that we would have to go back, reopen our accounts from the time the objection was raised, and change all our accounts, and that would have significant financial implications for us.
Well, yeah, thank you. So my question relates to the significant risk that you've heard detailed on the outline order plan, particularly with reference to the pension fund. You won't know about I'm chair of Mercer Pension Fund, I'm also chair of the Northern Pool and LAP, and sit on the Shadow Advisory Board of the Local Government Association. So I'm aware of significant changes. There's also about the DCLG with regard to separation of the administrative authorities from the pension funds themselves, and to me that poses some significant risks potentially to the authority. So I'm not asking you to answer the question, but in your you said that you're going to detail a plan moving forward, and you've highlighted a risk to the fund, to the authority, by the liabilities of the fund. Interest in the Northmerseyside Pension Fund is 100% funded, so that isn't a significant risk potentially moving forward, but there is a significant risk in the separation of the functions of the administrative authority and the pension fund, and I'm wondering if it's something you might look into and report back in future meetings. That's a bit more of a request than a question.
Come back on the screen?
Yeah, definitely handy that. I'm also the manager on the pension fund, so we'd love to have them both levels.
Thank you. Yeah, we've got
well, thanks very much, Chair. On the same page, Paul's mentioned of the Ofsted report on children's services should declare a member of the improvement board. Perhaps you can't hold that doesn't understand quite what they look at. Will they be looking at the split of spending between the agency and full-time staff, or how the council will be using early intervention to try and reduce the number of children they look after? What do your people look at to assess work of Ofsted? The regular monitoring reports, most recently was about 3 weeks ago, and they'll be doing their final visit, probably in May, to study the work of the department to see if it's improved. But what role will the auditors be playing in?
Yeah, sure. So this is obviously off the report from again a few years ago. And we would initially review the Ofsted report, and then it's a case of looking at the procedures put in place to address the issues and the action involved and seeing how they've progressed over the years. So again, it's more a case of looking at the steps that have been put in place to correct the issues raised and to see if there's been a problem through.
Thank you, sir.
No further comments, and there's nothing else on the agenda, so it won't be clear. So it just leaves me to thank officers Ian Miles and Nico Neal to sit through in case they were needed, and of course Mr. Price. So the meeting is concluded. Thank you all for coming.
Thank you, Chair,
and for the presentation.